President Marcos pitches the Philippines as a prime investment destination to business leaders in Brunei. He cited key legislations and enhanced regulatory processes as reasons that make Manila a strategic business partner for its Southeast Asian neighbor. Marcos also says the creation of the state's first sovereign wealth fund shows his administration's commitment to bankroll projects that will help fuel economic growth. After his two-day state visit to Brunei, President Marcos will be in Singapore this afternoon. He will deliver the keynote address at the International Institute for Strategic Studies Shangri-La Dialogue 2024. Marcos will also invite Singapore's new president and prime minister to the Philippines. The chief executive will stay in Singapore until late Friday and is expected to arrive home early Saturday. The Philippines' poll body chair requesting the Commission on Bank to prohibit the use of deepfakes and AI-generated content in campaign materials. In a letter to the On Bank dated May 28, COMELEC Chair George Garcia underscored the serious threat of AI and deepfake use to sow election disinformation. He says abusing this technology can undermine the integrity of the elections and the credibility of the candidates and election authorities.
Kukumbinsin ko po ang ating Commission and Bank, ipagbawal namin sa campaign ang paggamit ng deepfakes at saka po AI. Sapagkat madami pong nalilito, madaming misrepresentation, madaming hindi po makatotohanan na nangyayari kapag ginagamit po yan.
The Philippine ICT Department clarifies it is not entirely ruling out banning TikTok. That's amid calls here at home and in the U.S. to block access to the short-form video app. A Philippine lawmaker has called for banning social media platforms controlled by so-called foreign adversaries to address potential espionage concerns. These apps include TikTok, whose parent company is based in China. The ICT asserts it needs to be careful in supporting a ban on social media apps, especially since they benefit small businesses.
We are for regulation. We are actually not against banning. We're saying let's regulate and then let's look at all the facts. And if it warrants banning, we ban. We want a equal application of the law. Kaya nga sabi ko, let's not single out a particular application. So what I will say actually should be applicable to all of them, including Facebook, including Twitter. These are also being used by MSMEs for their social media marketing platforms. Mm-hmm. So this is just a technology. I understand that there are evils of it, but there are also good of it. Facebook Marketplace, although a lot of this is working on the underground economy, they still contribute. We all pay VAT. We all pay for logistics. We all pay for, di ba, yung mga lalamove, etc. They're all being used by the general public who does not have enough capital to produce big offices and big places. They're using this to make ends meet.
Meanwhile, the DICT said some systems in the Philippine National Police's Firearms and Explosives Office are now up and running following last week's massive data breach. The hacker stole 1.5 terabytes of data, affecting over 500,000 Filipinos.
It's an ongoing issue. We're cleaning up all the remnants of the attacker. The attacker is persistent, is very patient, and seems to work like a professional. No, he or she spent 7 weeks trying to penetrate one system, but some of the systems at least have already been cleared of the vestiges of the attacker.
Meanwhile, Philippine Congressman Bienvenido Abante Jr., the proponent of the measure calling for a ban against TikTok and other social media apps, is urging the public to voluntarily discontinue their use of TikTok. He insists the platform is being used by China to collect users' data, which could compromise national security.
Kapin ko lang po sa ating mga kababayan ay ito. Red light po natin, mga kaibigan, ang nangyayari sa ating bayan ngayon. Alam po natin na ay mga kababayan tayo, mga influencers na tinatawag, na kumikita sa application na ito. Pero ino-urge ko po lang lahat ng TikTok users, kahit wala pang batas, i-delete nyo na po ang app na ito sapagkat hindi naman to ano eh, hindi naman to trying to cut off the freedom of ano eh, of speech.
The worst form of human trafficking. That's how DSWD Secretary Rex Gatchalian calls the alarming sale of babies online. Earlier this month, a mother was arrested for trying to sell her 8-day-old baby through Facebook. The DSWD says it has monitored and reported dozens of Facebook pages involved in the sale of infants. Secretary Gatchalian is calling on Meta to take down all those pages and for the government to be more aggressive in regulating social media sites.
They use ICP, the children are being traded, and then they're not following the process set forth by law for proper adoption. So trafficking, this is the worst type of human cruelty. It's trafficking, but it's happening blatantly in our social media pages. And what have we done so far? Minus the monitoring, we've been working with PNP and NBI to catch these culprits. But at the same time, we've been talking to Facebook. In fact, after this incident, Facebook brought down around 12 of these 40 or so pages.
At least 7 people killed, while over 51,000 more were affected by the first storm to hit the Philippines this year. Initial assessment also showed damage to agriculture, now at nearly 23 million pesos. The Social Welfare and Development Department has begun distributing financial assistance to affected families in Quezon Province. Thousands of food packs also distributed to areas ravaged by aghon.
We did start paying out yesterday those in the initial list, but because kulang pa yung list, they're still coming in. We have yet to collate. But again, based on the instruction of the president before he left, and we were chatting all the way from Friday, Sunday, it's always food packs now so that they have food to eat, and then financial assistance so that they have recovery money naman to fix their home. So DSWD has more than sufficient funds in our central office, and we're just waiting for the list to come in.
State Weather Bureau Pagasa has declared the start of the rainy season in the Philippines. Let's now get an update on the weather from Pagasa forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Lori?
Good afternoon, Ms. Denise, and to all our viewers and listeners. That's right. Onset of rainy season in the country has officially started today. The occurrence of scattered rain showers, frequent thunderstorms, and the passage of Typhoon Aghon in the past few days, as well as the southwest monsoon, have brought significant rains over the western sections of Luzon and Visayas, and it signifies the start of the rainy season in the country. However, there may be breaks in rainfall that extend over a few days or weeks, also referred as monsoon breaks, so it can happen in the next few days or few weeks. With this, Pagasa will continue to monitor the weather and climate situation in the country. And then meanwhile, cloudy skies with scattered rains and thunderstorms will be expected over Ilocos Region, Central Luzon, Metro Manila, Mimaropa, Calabarzon, Western Visayas, Sambanga Peninsula, and Basilan, Sulu, and Tawi-Tawi due to southwest monsoon. Meanwhile, for Batanes and Babuin Islands, they will experience generally cloudy skies with scattered rains and thunderstorms due to frontal system. Then the rest of the country, they will experience generally fair weather apart from localized thunderstorms. Typhoon Aghon is also already outside the Philippine area of responsibility as of 12 p.m. today, so it's not likely to directly affect any parts of the country as of now. This is the latest from Pagasa. This is Lori De La Cruz.
Thanks, Lori. Philippine toll regulators green light the toll hike for the North Luzon Expressway. Beginning June 4, that's next Tuesday, motorists traveling anywhere within NLEX's open system or from Balintawa, Caloocan City to Marilao, Bulacan will pay at least 5 pesos more to use the expressway. Those traveling NLEX end-to-end will pay as much as 81 pesos more. This is the second tranche of a toll hike after regulators implemented a similar increase in June last year. President Marcos vows several improvements in Manila's main gateway will be felt starting next year. Speaking to the Filipino community in Brunei, Marcos said billions of pesos will be spent to upgrade the Ninoy Aquino International Airport. He says while the full rehabilitation of NAIA will take years, upgrades will be evident by 2025.
Pagbalik po ninyo sa Pilipinas, we hope to also welcome you to a new and upgraded Manila International Airport. Dahil sinimulan na po natin, dahil nakakahiya naman po, eh, yung airport natin, napabayaan na ng husto. At pagka yung mga pinag-aaral tungkol sa mga airport, hindi maganda po ang report sa airport natin sa Maynila. Kaya tayo ay kakalagda rin po natin. Meron tayo po 170.6 billion pesos na idadalhin para pagandahin ang ating mga passenger terminal, ang ating mga airside facilities, at saka mas madali ang paglipat mula sa isang terminal hanggang sa kabilang terminal, mula sa airport hanggang sa terminal ng bus para makauwi sa probinsya.
Back in February, a consortium led by the San Miguel Group won the bidding for NAIA's rehabilitation with a price tag of 170 billion pesos. An energy advocacy group frowns on the call of Senate President Francis Escudero to lift the moratorium on the construction of new coal-fired power plants. The Power for People Coalition says there is no truth. Coal is a cheaper source of energy. The group also believes Energy Secretary Rafael Otilia has not been doing enough to prevent the recent power shortages and high prices of electricity.
Hindi totoo na mas mura ang coal plants. In fact, siya ang pinakamalaking source ngayon ng burden ng mga electric consumers, hindi lang sa Meralco franchise area, kundi sa buong bansa. Yun ang pinaka nakakalungkot dito, no, kasi hostage tayo eh. Ang may kapabayaan dito ay Department of Energy eh. Sa forecasting, sa pag-i-insure, at kaya nga nagda-doubt na nga kami sa kapasidad ni DOE head Lutilia, no, na lagi niya na lang sinasabi walang dapat pangambahan.
Philippine shares further sink in negative territory as investors remain cautious on the lack of market-moving activity. More in this report. Regional equities and bonds came under pressure this Wednesday with higher Treasury yields in the U.S. and hawkish comments from a Federal Reserve speaker dragging sentiment. The MSCI Asia-Pacific Index slid for a second session, while Treasuries in Asia held steady ahead of America's core PCE data out on Thursday. Here at home, another tumble for Philippine shares, with the main index falling to the 6,400 level. Investors opting to remain on the sidelines ahead of economic data releases stateside.
Right now, we're at or nearing oversold conditions. We're also approaching the critical 6,400 support level, where the recent low is at. Hopefully, we also see a successful test of that 6,400 support level, as that can be a catalyst for a rebound.
You have to ask yourself, what type of investor are you? Mm-hmm. I guess it's not really for the trader who wants to make a quick buck. But mm-hmm. if you're a long-term investor and you can afford to hold on to stocks, I mean, now's a good time. And maybe, I guess, the focus should be on more defensive issues that are still doing well regardless of what happens to the economy.
In corporate stories, Globe Telecom gets fully on board the AI train. It named Antonio Bonifacio as its first chief artificial intelligence officer, who will lead its AI development and enablement group. The cybersecurity and data privacy expert is concurrently the telco giant's chief information security officer. Globe's new AI group will seek to maximize the use of the technology to improve its operations, service delivery, and customer experience. Next, to Asia Best Group, which clarified it has no plans to take Okada Manila public. Asia Best is a unit of Universal Entertainment, which is the parent company of the casino, resort, and hotel. This followed an online report that said Universal is eyeing an initial public offering of Okada Manila of up to $750 million in 2025. Meanwhile, for Rockwell Land, at a stockholders' meeting today, it announced three new projects this year in Bulacan and in Batangas provinces. Rockwell's premium office developers also making its venture outside Metro Manila this July with the launch of its first office building in Cebu City. All these as Rockwell declared 500 hectares in land bank seen to generate more revenues for the company. Also from the Lopez Group and from ANC's parent company, ABS-CBN Corporation's Board of Directors will seek shareholders' approval for a stock grant. The retention program covers up to 85 million shares to be awarded at the end of a five-year period. ABS-CBN says the stock grant is geared towards retaining key executives, whom it says are crucial to maintaining its competitive edge. The move is also still subject to regulatory approvals. The Philippine government sent to enforce new policies regulating the sale of e-cigarettes next month. Jackie Pascual reports.
The Philippine Trade and Industry Department will implement the vape law beginning June, and among the new requirements is for all vape products be registered with DTI. This means importation and manufacturing of vaporized nicotine and non-nicotine products and novel tobacco products must pass through the DTI certification process first. A Philippine Standard or PS mark and Import Commodity Clearance or ICC sticker are also required. DTI said there will be a six-month transition period.
Hahayaan muna ubusin yung mga inventory na nakapasok na dahil hayaan muna ibenta. Pagdating ng January 5, 2025, yun na po yung magma-market clearing tayo na wala na dapat kahit anong vape na walang PS license yung manufacturer or ICC.
The Bureau of Internal Revenue will also affix tax stamps on vape products starting next month to ensure that unregulated products do not spread to many areas.
Enforcing the this affixture of excise stamp tax beginning June 1 on vape products, it would be a great help not only for the BIR but also on the business or the vapor industry.
Nograles added that DTI will continue to ensure that flavored vape will not be allowed, especially to minors. They will also check reports of vape with marijuana oil.
Yung vape kasi, lalo na yung mga liquid na papasukan ng marijuana or cannabis. Sa kasalukuyan, sa pag-iikot natin sa mga monitoring enforcement, pag may nahuli tayo, immediately refer agad yan sa PDEA.
Government vows to strictly implement the new vape law, especially as smuggled cigarettes continue to affect tax collection. In April, the BIR confiscated smuggled cigarettes in warehouses in Agusan del Sur and Surigao del Sur with a 219 million pesos tax liability.
Illicit trade harms businesses and livelihoods, so we encourage everyone to report any signs of illicit cigarettes or vape products to the BIR. Let's protect our economy.
In 2023 alone, BIR said government lost over 25 billion pesos of revenues due to illicit trade of tobacco products. And a study says that may even grow further this year.
We are still exerting efforts, best efforts to collect or to increase collection of tobacco products, excise tax on tobacco products.
Officials now want to make sure the government collects proper taxes on vape and cigarette products while balancing it with the Filipinos' push for a healthy life. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
13 Filipino crew members aboard a vessel attacked by Houthi rebels are all safe. The Migrant Workers Department says it is in communication with the shipping and manning agencies to monitor the condition of the seafarers. Houthi rebels hit the Marshall Islands flagged vessel Lax with four missiles near Yemen's Hodeidah port in the southern Red Sea Tuesday. Houthi rebels have attacked vessels in the Red Sea to condemn Israel's war in Gaza.